Today I am going to talk on the divine revelation of Jesus Christ. Our text is Matthew Gospel chapter 16, 13 to 20. Who is Jesus? Jesus took his disciples away from the crowd into a retreat setting. His main intention was to review his ministry and to clarify his own identity and his expectation of them. Right from the beginning, there were crowds following Jesus and they were curious enough to know who he is. In Matthew 8:27, our people said, "What kind of man is this?" And again in 11:2, they said, "Are you the one who was to come?" And then they suspected, "Could this be the son of David?" In Matthew 12:23. Now all this question came to a climax in this focused, intense retreat with the disciples. And the second thing we find in this passage is Jesus' intention of building the church was revealed. Thirdly, we see Jesus preparing the disciples to take up his leadership after his departure. So Jesus arrived in the region of Caesarea Philippi to be free from the critics of the religious leaders and from the common people and to settle the critical question of his identity with his disciples. It was a quiet place at the headquarters of Jordan River. And in Matthew 16:14, some people like Herod in Matthew 14:1-2 thought Jesus was John the Baptist. Others saw Jesus a miracle worker, especially when they saw Jesus raising him from the dead. They thought Elijah, the miracle worker, has come. Still others thought Jesus was Jeremiah, the prophet of doom who prophesied during the final decades before Judah was exiled to Babylon. The list included several of the other prophets, including Isaiah, whose prophecies Jesus fulfilled in Matthew, and from whom Jesus quoted many quotations. Before answering to this question, Jesus posed two questions. Number one, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And the second question, who do you say that I am? The Lord ignored to answer the first question, and he answered his disciple the second question, "Whom say ye that I am?" Peter immediately confessed that you are Christ, the Son of living God. By saying this, he recognized Jesus as the Son of Man, is the Son of God. By saying the word Christ, Peter put him on the throne of Israel as the Lord's anointed prophet, priest and king. By saying the word the Son of living God, Peter put him on the throne of the universe. Peter's great confession is the cardinal creed of the church. Jesus the Christ is God's own Son, is the Messiah. He is God incarnate, he is truly man, he is God in essence and in substance. This should be the exact confession of all of us concerning Christ. After appreciating Peter and thanking God for the revelation that he got from Heavenly Father, Jesus said a memorable words. He looked at Peter and said, "Thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." We see that Jesus used two Greek words, and these two Greek words are distinct. One is the Petros. Petros is a masculine gender that denotes a loose stone or pebble or small stone. Whereas Petra is a feminine gender denotes a rock or a cliff form which is immovable. It's a huge, massive rock. And you know, we must always remember when Jesus spoke that he will build his church, he was not saying that he will build the church on Peter, but on Christ himself. We must remember that the Lord was talking to the disciples who as a Hebrew were rooted and grounded in the Old Testament understanding of the scriptures. They were well aware of the Old Testament meaning of the rock. And the rock is never used as a symbolically of man. It is figuratively and only of God and Christ. Christ is the foundation stone if you look at Isaiah chapter 28 verse 16. And then the rejected stone in Psalm 118 verses 22. So the Lord Jesus did not trifle with symbols. He took up the well-understood Hebrew symbol of deity, the rock, according to Deuteronomy chapter 32 verses 21, and declared upon this rock, that means he was talking about himself, that is God himself, that Jesus Christ himself as a rock. He said, I will build my church. Peter understood the Lord's utterance correctly. If you read it, 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 6 to 8, the view that Peter is a rock on which the church is built is false. There are many confession teaching that is going on. Peter is a rock and upon him the church is built. This understanding has to be refuted. Peter was simply a stone, the first stone, perhaps just as a stone, one of many to be built upon the rock, according to 1 Peter 2, 4 to 5. All the believers, the servants of God, are just a stone that we are built upon the foundation, which is Jesus Christ himself. And Jesus said, the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Hades is a realm of death, and the gates perhaps is a symbol of entrance to that gate. The Lord was declaring that the death will not triumph over his church. We read his triumphant shout in Revelation 1:18, I am Alpha and I am Omega. I am he that liveth and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And have the keys of hell and death. Death can no more hold the Christians than it could hold Christ. One day, the dead in Christ will rise shouting, O grave, where is thy victory? According to 1 Corinthians 15:58. Another view is that since gate is the place where the rulers of the ancient city meet, according to Genesis 19:1 and Ruth 4, the gates of hell symbolizes a place where Satan and his fallen angels take counsel against the church. But either Satan nor his host are a match for the spirit-born, spirit-built church. The Lord Jesus spoiled the satanic host at the cross, according to Colossians 2:15. And he has equipped us to war victoriously against him in Ephesians 6:11-12 says. Put the two thoughts together, we conclude that Christ has promised that either the power of death nor the power of devil can prevail against the church, which is his building. If anybody have prevailed the gates, they have taken over the city. But Jesus said the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Most of the time we are frightened that it is the devil who's threatening us. It's the devil that is trying to, torment us. And most of the people, the Christians, have been carried away in spite of this wonderful promise that Christ gave to the church. He said, no matter what, the Satan cannot overtake the church. We are not defensive, but we are offensive. It is we who offend Satan. It is we who trouble Satan. Because Jesus said, Satan cannot overtake you. We have wonderful promise because the church is built by Christ. Jesus not only established the church, he is so zealous in keeping the sanctity of the church. If you read in Revelation chapter 1, John saw a wonderful vision. And there he saw a 7 candlestick which denotes the church. And Jesus is among the candlesticks. That tells us how careful and how zealous the Lord Jesus Christ is for the church. And the church is called the bride of Christ. It's a privilege to be the bride of Christ. When the Lord Jesus Christ is going to come and take us to be with him. So we need to maintain our holiness and righteousness. And we need to safeguard the garment that he has given to us. Not being defiled with his worldly pleasures. We are set aside. We are set apart. We are not of this world. We are exclusively for Christ. We are for Christ. Let us live with this conviction that Jesus Christ is the Messiah, the Son of God. He is going to come again. He is going to take us with him. So let us prepare ourselves. Let us be ready for the coming of Christ. May God bless you.